Hello friends, welcome to the e-learning session of very crucial topic, that is tuberculosis part 1. So this is the part 1 of the lecture, and first we will see the case scenario. A 28-year-old male was admitted to the hospital with complaints of low grade fever, loss of weight, loss of appetite. Over 6 months he developed the gradually worsening cough productive of yellow sputum. A chest x-ray shows the infiltrates in both the lung, while the sputum smear examination was done and it shows the acid fast bacilli. So what would be the most probable diagnosis and causative agent responsible for this situation? The disease is pulmonary tuberculosis and the agent is Mycobacterium tuberculosis. This case will frequently ask in your exam as long question, so take a note of it. Now the objective of this part of the session. The first we will see the history, then classification of the mycobacteria, then antigenic structure of the mycobacteria, then pathogenesis of tuberculosis, and finally the clinical manifestation. Now in the history aspect, the tuberculosis, which is known since the ancient time, even it is associated with the Egyptian mummy. In 1882, Robert Koch isolated the tubercle bacilli and proved its causative role in tuberculosis as it satisfies the Koch's postulate. For this, he got the Nobel Prize in 1905. Now the classification of the mycobacteria. Mycobacteria is broadly classified in 3 groups. The first one is Mycobacterium tuberculosis complex, which is responsible for tuberculosis in man. Then Mycobacterium leprae, which is a causative agent of lepra. And then non-tuberculous mycobacteria, that is also called the NTM. These are the diverse group of mycobacteria. Among these 3 groups, Mycobacterium leprae and NTM, we will discuss in next lecture. So let's talk about the Mycobacterium tuberculosis complex. The first and very important member of this group is Mycobacterium tuberculosis, which is responsible for tuberculosis in man. Then Mycobacterium rovis, which is also known as bovine tubercle bacillus. Then Mycobacterium africanum, which is isolated from West African cases. Then Mycobacterium microti, which can cause rare and less virulent cases. Then others are Mycobacterium caprae, Mycobacterium pinnipedi, and Mycobacterium canadi. Now the antigenic structure like cell wall of the mycobacteria. The cell wall of the mycobacteria is made up of several layers like mycolic acid, arabinogalactan, peptidoglycan layer, and lipid bilayer. First, the mycolic acid, which is made up of the fatty acid, and it is responsible for acid fastness of this bacilli. Then arabinogalactan, which helps to survive of Mycobacterium tuberculosis within the macrophages. Then the third layer is peptidoglycan layer, which is responsible for maintaining of rigidity and shape of the bacteria. And the last one is lipid bilayer, which is also known as cell membrane. One important antigen is lipoarabinomenin, which helps bacilli to attach to the host cells. Now the pathogenesis part. Here the source of infection is human, which causes tuberculosis, and bovine, source in which person should acquire infection by unpasteurized infected milk. Then mode of infection. The first and most common route is inhalation of droplet nuclei, which is generated while coughing, sneezing, or speaking of infected people. There may be 3,000 there may be 3000 droplet nuclei per cough, which may remain suspended in the air for several hours. And these are the two other mode of transmission, which is inoculation and ingestion. Now the risk factor that promotes the tuberculosis. The first is bacillary load. At least 10 raised to 4 bacilli per ml in sputum is required for an effective transmission. Adult patients with cavitary lesion in lung have more bacillary load in sputum and transmit more efficiently. Overcrowding in poorly ventilated room is also one of the risk factor to get tuberculosis. Another one is low cell mediated immunity. In patients with HIV, post transplantation, chronic renal failure, diabetes, IV drug abusers, and smoking, here this type of people are more easily infected with tuberculosis than the normal people. And the two extreme age periods, which also more prone to get this type of infection. Now the sequence of pathogenic event. First, patient get infection through the droplet nuclei via inhalation route. Tubercle bacilli is present in this droplet, and majority of this droplet nuclei is trapped in upper airways, while less than 10% of small droplet nuclei to the alveoli. Then mycobacteria are binds with surface of macrophage with help of lipoarabinomannan. This leads to entry of bacilli into the macrophage. Then phagocytosis of the bacilli occurs in macrophage. This process is enhanced by C3b mediated opsonization. But TB bacilli are survived in macrophage due to lipoarabinomannan, which impairs phagosome lysosome fusion. If this bacilli remains in the dormant state for months or even years without any clinical symptoms, then it is called the latent tuberculosis. If the bacilli successfully survives and replicate within the macrophage, then macrophage eventually ruptures and bacilli releases and infect other macrophage, and this cycle continues. Tuberculosis is classified into pulmonary tuberculosis and extrapulmonary tuberculosis. This pulmonary tuberculosis is again classified into primary and secondary pulmonary tuberculosis. So here is the difference between these two. Primary one is result from the initial infection of tubercle bacilli, which is seen in children, while secondary one is seen as reinfection or reactivation of latent form of tuberculosis, which is usually seen in adult patient. In primary, upper part of the lower lobe and lower part of the upper lobe of lung is involved, while in secondary, apical and posterior segment of upper lobe of lung is involved. In primary, there is a Gohn's focus, which is formed by the fibrotic nodular region, and in secondary, calcified nodules is formed, which is also called as SMN focus. Clinical features of both type of this infection is similar, which we'll observe into the next slide. But the fate of primary is by healing of lesion and calcification of complex, while in secondary, the fate is by bronchogenic spread of necrotic material in interlung or intralung, expectoration of the bacteria-laden lung, and hematogenous spread leading to the extrapulmonary tuberculosis. Now the clinical manifestation. It may be asymptomatic or may be present the symptoms like cough, afternoon fever, weight loss, night sweats, and blood-stained sputum. While extrapulmonary tuberculosis is results from hematogenous spread of tubercle bacilli to various organs like brain. In brain, it shows the TB meningitis. It occurs mostly in children, and the second is lymphatics, which is most common form and showing 35% of all EPTB cases. Most common site are post cervical and supra cervicular lymph nodes. Then pleura. Here it shows the pleural tuberculosis, which accounts for 20% of all EPTB cases. Then disseminated tuberculosis, which is also called the miliary tuberculosis, due to formation of yellowish granulomatous lesions like miliate cysts. Then TB of bones and joints, especially a TB of spine. And then finally the genitourinary tuberculosis. In this, patient gets the renal TB and genital TB. In genital TB, mostly in female patient, fallopian tubes and endometrium is commonly involved. How the transmission and progression of the disease occurs? First, among all people get infected, 5% are going in early progression, while 95% are in an initial containment. Among this 95, only 5% of the patient get late progression, while 90% of the patients is self-cured with immunity. Then HIV associated with TB. TB is one of the most common opportunistic disease among HIV infected person due to low CMI. Worldwide, TB occurs in 70 to 80% of all HIV infected individuals. Extrapulmonary tuberculosis is being more common than the TB of lungs. In 2017, 1.6 million people are died because of the TB. That include the 3 lakh people with HIV. On this World TB Day, which is on 24th March, WHO comes with new end TB strategy. This strategy aims to end the global TB epidemic with targets to reduce the TB deaths by 95% and cut new cases by 90% between the 2015 and 2035. No family get burdens with expenses due to TB. Even government India also implemented NTEP, that is National Tuberculosis Eradication Program, in the place of RNTCP, that is Revised National Tuberculosis Control Program, which we will learn in the second part of this lecture. So this was all about the TB part 1. I hope you will like it, and please go through the TB in your books, because it is very important and frequently asked topic in your exam. Thank you.